one where we actually limit the LED presences that I'm aware of is Buford Highway.
The 141 signage requirements.
It's compatibility. There are some sign ordinance requirements, but it doesn't prohibit LED.
So I had another conversation with Commissioner Tam as we were talking about a couple other things about this, and I talked to Jane about it as well. And he said, we'll just bring it up at a work session and have staff work on something for you. And I said, well, that's kind of what I thought we weren't supposed to do. And he said, yeah, it's probably best if we bring it up. But he indicated, why don't you guys talk through it? We'll talk through it to see if we want to have a public hearing about it. So I wanted to put that out there as a discussion point, or at least a, hey, let's wait for them to come back to us. Perhaps, Tom, you can clarify if that's your understanding of their preference, given some things that happened last year, as far as the workflow that they'd like to see out of it.
I would agree. Yeah, we would, if the Planning Commission discussed it and wanted to make a recommendation, they'd make a recommendation. You'd make a recommendation to the Board of Commissioners. They could then decide if it's something they had interest in. Mm-hmm. And if so, they could either kick off the initiative to work on it, or they could send it back to the Planning Commission for you to provide that direction.
Do we need to each speak with the commissioner who appointed us to see if there's any interest on their part before we even request them as a follow-up?
My understanding is that's what would take place. If it takes two Board of Commissioners have to get together to get an item on their agenda. Mm-hmm. And once two of them put it on their agenda, that debate would then take place there to find out if there's interest. So I don't have the opinion that you need to talk to each board member.
So I want to let you guys know that ball, I think, is kind of rolling already, so it didn't come as a surprise, and let you know that's a conversation I had with some folks. And
do
some
we know what
well.
The what the verbiage is of the overlay district for Buford, what it says?
I can go ahead and pull it up. That was something that we recently, you know, there was concerns
right.
about, you know, a variety of businesses having that. So as it pertains to stations. Specifically, you know, there was a lot of things dealing with fuel stations in general on this overlay. So for lighting, signage, electronic message boards, and automated changeable copy signs are prohibited other than on parcels being utilized as a fuel station. And again, that was, you know, after discussions with, you know, the days of fuel stations having manual
sure.
letters out there.
That they change all the time.
And so, but if...
And what does the Peachtree Parkway overlay say about signs?
We don't prohibit it for Peachtree. We have more generalized standards for signage compatibility.
So, base materials match the building. Wall signs will not cover architectural features of the building. If there's more than one sign on a site, they need to complement each other. Wall mounted raceway needs to be painted to match the building. Shielding light sources.
That was before those LED signs came to be the standard to the overlay.
It was right before, but right after that, I think really the primary concerns at that time for that overlay was looking at Johns Creek, looking at the landscaping in particular and the architectural quality of the development in Johns Creek and wanting that. But I would say yes, different.
Because it was what, a year and a half ago, maybe a year, when that came up during a work session upstairs, and they were talking about the LED signs and how it was becoming an industry standard, so you would have people who wanted to change their billboards to become LED. I remember that conversation. I just don't remember what all happened with it.
And then with 141, there is, you know, again, a desire for some large signs, or at least mm-hmm. one large sign that I remember that was going to be changeable, mm-hmm. like a video type of screen.
Oh, yes.
So, and that was after the overlay.
It lights up the whole sky.
But, I mean, that's, so I don't, do we have, in our sign ordinance right now, there's nothing that regulates any specific, component of the LED fence?
Well, what we've got is, we've got a prohibited signs, there is a section for automated changeable copy, but there are exceptions. It's once every 3 hours, they can't change more frequently than that, or devices that display date, time, or temperature, but there's a billboard exception. So billboards have been upgraded, can change to that.
I read there's a foot candle measurement as well, which is a,
Yes.
obviously a measurement of light.
That's whatever, how much light they emit, I mean, some of them look pretty low-key, and it's not a big deal, and some, you know, extremely.
I don't know how often those are measured with a light meter, you know, and if they're just kind of fired up by the sign company, and I know the one by us is changing right now every 2 minutes.
So not exceeding.
So there's an enforcement, that probably will happen at some point with that, I would assume.
That's actually, we got a complaint on that one, one near Vickery.
Yeah.
Got a complaint on that last week, about it changing every 12 seconds or something.
Oh, wow.
I sent an email to Steve about it when I saw it as well, so.
It wasn't the only one he got.
So you had some other concerns about other signs that you wanted to talk about as well? The signs that stayed around at subdivisions for a long time?
Yeah, I just, you know, I've, the sign thing maybe is close to my heart for some odd reason.
Well, maybe it's aesthetic,
That's exactly what it is, and I feel a, I've heard this from other people as well, that something feels different when we get off at Windward versus McFarland, and Tom and I have had this conversation, we have there's two issues, there's the ordinance issue, then there's the enforcement of the ordinance, and I think the bulk of what's out there as far as that goes is an enforcement issue, which I don't know that I know that we don't necessarily have a say in that. So I don't know if you want to speak to that any further.
Well, I can tell you, tell the Planning Commission as a whole what some of what we talked about, which was code enforcement has just recently expanded their staff, and they're putting some of those additional resources toward signs. And one of the areas they're doing that is that Highway 9, south end of the county corridor, which it is a messy area as far as signs. It was the historical north-south path, so you've got a lot of old businesses there that had signs before we had regulations. So they got non-conforming signs, grandfathered signs, and a lot of new businesses pop up and put on sometimes more than they're allowed, trying to keep up and compete with those 20, 30, 40-year-old signs that are bigger than what we allow today. So, some new resources have been brought online, and they're going toward that to some extent.
And the subdivision signs, they were talked about too, you know, the ones on the wooden post that stay forever.
Mm-hmm. Right. There's, driving around the county, I see a lot of those that I imagine do not have a permit. Mm-hmm. And I know that just based on the size or the proximity to the right of way.
Is there a time limit that those are allowed to stay up in the sign ordinance with a new development?
It's hard to say because so many of them don't fit anything in the ordinance.
Because they're usually right next to their entrance sign. Yes.
Now, the sign ordinance does provide for signs while a property has lots under development and for sale.
Is it 12 or 16 square feet? The allotted size. It's one of the two.
It's rather small compared to what you see typically.
Right, and that's, I made the suggestion in email that perhaps we include with building permits or when we approve a sketch plan, we say, here's our sign ordinance. Please adhere to this, because I think part of it becomes I just saw that's what that guy did, and I'm not gonna bother look up the sign ordinance because it must be okay if that's there, and so I think it becomes a matching game. Perhaps with no ill intent, but just say that's what I saw, and so that's what I assume is okay. And so the result is we have the normal sign from a normal neighborhood is 4x8 sheet of plywood that's been wrapped, and it's somewhere around double the size of what it's supposed to be. And then there's a lot of them. There's them leading up to development,
and not just one.
And then they're telling you that you pass the development to turn around and go back.
And there's things stuck on them over 55 or something that stick out beyond the dimension. Mm-hmm.
Have you seen what Cherokee County I think that they still do it, but it's several years ago.
The TS program?
Well, whenever they were under development, I don't know what they call it, but they had like a panel, and you could pretty much buy getting your name on that panel, so it would provide for like a direction, like you come up to a street corner, you wouldn't see signs that are just, you know, sticking over there large for advertising different neighborhoods. They would all be in this neat organized row.
Board of Commissioners talked about that in work session several years ago, that they wanted to do that, and they decided against it. I don't remember why.
You remember that? Probably expensive.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, they could pay for it. They could lease the space off of it or whatever you do, but.
Well, but you have to be able to change it.
Over who was going to get the bid and all that kind of stuff, and I think just people lost interest in it when they got into the complexity of, or how are we actually going to do them? Whose name's going on top versus on bottom? How much does it cost?
Take a bid for it.
Right.
Highest bidder goes on top.
So they didn't get to the bottom of all those types of questions, though. I think it just kind of fizzled out before it got there.
And I know there are some in Cherokee County now where all the little things are missing. Now you just have to post. I mean, it's,
So I don't know about now. I know whenever they first did it, it was nice because it took away a lot of big in-your-face advertising off of the corners.
But I do remember when they went and had that big discussion about that.
I think it was actually in a version of the ordinance for a while. Then it came out, our ordinance.
Well, and Windward, too. I mean, if you go back 20 years, it looked a lot different than it does now.
Yeah, you don't have to go back 20 years.
Sure. But I'm saying if you do go back 20 years, you know, I mean, that there was nothing on that road, and it was full of neighborhood signs and turn here and come back here, you know, all of that, because that's when they were developing and that's when they were growing. And they've put a lot of money into it recently, all that landscaping and all the signage and everything that they've done there is really nice, but it's taken them probably 25 years to get to that point.
Anybody else have anything to add? Okay. So
we'll wait and
you've
see.
Got to, yeah.
Yeah, they say they're going to move forward with the LED conversation.
Okay.
I guess we'll hear from them.
Okay. All right. Next is audience outburst discussion. Mr. Brown.
This is one I just like to follow up with every so often, make sure we're all.
It's a good idea.
We've been through this before.
I thought maybe there had been an audience outburst and I missed it.
No, and actually when I saw it on the agenda, I asked myself the same thing. Did I put this on there? Was also an issue or just follow up? And I'm pretty sure it was just follow up the last time we talked about it. I think we identified that we would revisit it every once in a while, make sure we're all familiar with it. What I passed out is something I just cut and paste from, it was an email I sent Pam last year, and the email was a summary of a discussion we had at the same meeting about a year ago, and it was just after we had had a meeting, a public hearing, where we had a lot of outbursts. I think it was that Dave's Creek 88 one. And we said, well, look, we kind of got caught off guard by that. We had this long period of nothing going on, a lot of quiet meetings, and we had one particular meeting where it was pretty vocal. The audience was really loud, just yelling out of turn. There's a long list of reasons why we don't want that. You know, number one, we don't want to give people the impression that's what our decision is based on, the kind of mob mentality. We want them to think our decision is based on the hearing and the facts and not just a show of hands and an angry bunch of people that showed up. We also want to provide a fair opportunity for everyone to give comments. And if someone's in the audience, they might be intimidated to come up and speak when they hear everyone else, you know, short of throwing things, but just yelling and calling names to people and all that. So we come up with this proposed four-tier system. I don't think we've ever got past step number two, which was just the step number one is Vanessa's general introduction, reminded everyone at the start of the meeting they're welcome to participate if they do so at the proper time. Tier two is Pam providing a warning that we don't want the kind of outburst. And then three and four ratcheted up from there. But since we've drafted it, we never got past two. just wanted to pass it out, give everyone a reminder we have it if we need it. And I'm not trying to suggest it's the only solution either. If we have another way we want to do it, I'm open to it. Whatever works for you, we'll try to make happen on our end. And that's it, unless there's any questions on that.
I have a question on your tier four, talking about time for an officer to arrive. Isn't there normally an officer there when we're having those, or not at our meeting?
Typically not at the Planning Commission.
And I remember when that happened, because I talked to you afterwards and I said, well, I was sitting up there thinking, well, if someone has to be escorted out, am I going to get up and escort them out? Or am I going to ask Tom to do that? Or who am I? I remember thinking that up there that night.
Yeah. We'll just make it.
Yes, Pam, we're going to require you
to. That's why I think it's so easy this way, as we say, you know, the person on the microphone when the camera's rolling is going to say, okay, you're going to, planning director, please escort this person out of the building. If they don't want to go, we'll take a break before we can call the sheriff's office to have them go. And at that point, people are going to get up and leave.
Yeah.
I don't think they're going to wait around and say, no, I want the sheriff to come and drag me out. Mm-hmm. But if it gets to that point, that's what will happen. I don't think it will. But
well, and if it's phrased in terms of everybody else now has to wait while we're waiting for the sheriff, you know, then there'll be some peer pressure maybe telling somebody to shut up.
Well, hopefully it will never get past number two.
No, I can't.
Like it has so far.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Think of a better way to do it, let us know.
2014, oh no, proposed changes to the UDC non-conforming lots.
It's in your look in your books. We've got the draft. This is coming from Kim's office. It's in the form of a resolution, but it is indeed a good change. It's right in the front after the schedule.
This is something that came out of the one of the Board of Commissioners' work sessions. There's one particular neighborhood that they're working on, and the solution would help this neighborhood, but they envision that it would help all the future cases as well. And the focus is that if someone, and you can read it, it's only a paragraph, but if someone gives their property to the county for right-of-way, they're not going to later be penalized for that if the dedication made their lot non-conforming. And I'll tell you how it's come. It's easiest probably to frame in the example they have it in. There's a more rural area of the county where someone over time went through and subdivided property again and again, all by easement. And there's no, there are no county roads. There's no county water. And it's a real mess. There was, I think, a community well was contaminated, and now there's not water in the area either. And all the homes in there are right at an acre, which is the minimum lot size for the district. So the county's trying to say, well, we'll try to do our part to come in and clean this up some. We would need to get the proper right-of-way to be able to put in a county road of any kind. Some of the homeowners were hesitant because they said, well, if I give you my part of my acre for road, then I have less than an acre, and if the structure I have on there burns down, you're not going to let me rebuild it because it's a non-conformity, and I can keep it and maintain it, but I can't rebuild it if it's destroyed. This language would essentially say, no, if you gave us that property, we'll dig back through the records, and we'll see that you gave it to us, and the only reason you're not conforming is because of that, and you won't be punished for it. That's my understanding of it. It's really something that.
So what about if they sell it? Does it follow the lot or does it follow the person?
I didn't hear that come up at the work session. And
okay.
I would imagine it goes with the lot. I think that's a good question.
Should, because otherwise it could be argued that it's a taking. Diminishing the value and usability of the rest of the lot, which I think this is supposed to be addressing, avoiding that problem.
I will make sure our legal staff have an answer to that for next week. This is something they've...
I mean, I
It really came out of legal staff.
I heard about the subdivision, it's a, or the, whatever you would call it at this point, I don't know what you would call it, but it's a...
Area.
An area of mobile homes, right? I mean,
there are a lot of mobile homes there, yeah.
And if... Essentially, it would be conforming if you put a different house on it, but it's non-conforming for the trailer, is that correct?
And again, I don't know a lot.
Because, I mean, my house is not on a lot, so on an acre lot, so obviously we allow houses in less.
Well, there's all different zoning districts, and a mobile home does always require an acre.
Right.
And if the property's agricultural, it would require an acre regardless. If it's some kind of like lake residential zoning, it would require more for a mobile home and less for a stick-built home.
Sure.
And that might be the case.
Okay.
I'll make sure the legal staff know the answer about, and when they present it, either they present it or Vanessa or I present it, we'll incorporate that answer into the presentation.
So this is a UDC change to take care of a problem that's in this one area. Is this gonna cause other new problems in other areas of the county?
I could see it could if a road widening goes in, and because it includes by condemnation and it reduces somebody's lot size, you know, and this could happen down on old Atlanta, where they're substantially widening the road, so a lot of people's lots are going to be skinnier. Yeah, I think this would cover that too.
I mean, definitely things like Highway 9, where you got setbacks and stuff that change, things can become non-conforming.
But then, do we just want to, instead of us just purchasing the full lot for the right of, you see what I mean? Mm-hmm. I mean, you could essentially, if you're buying the right of way, but it's going to cut back on someone's property that it would be taking, or that it would become a non-conforming lot, then at that point, when is it our responsibility to just buy the piece of land from the homeowner so that they can have a house, so that they can continue to live, and then we're not, I don't want to say stuck with, but then we're not stuck with something that's non-conforming and can never be changed, because now we've, you can't change the use then.
Well, but then the county can, go ahead.
I was going to say, this avoids the county having to buy the whole lot.
I realize, but my suggestion is maybe it's a better solution to buy the lot I'm not saying in this particular instance, I'm just saying we're changing the code for the whole county.
Mm-hmm.
This is to change the code for the whole county. So we have to think about how is it going to impact us in every situation.
But it is all keyed to that the county has somehow, by condemnation, by sale, or by dedication, acquired a part of what was their property.
Right.
Throwing them into a non-conforming situation.
Right.
And if it does throw them into a non-conforming situation, you may not get many people doing this by gift or by dedication. And so it may cost the county more for acquiring the amount of right-of-way that they need.
I realize it would cost more. I'm just wondering if it's a better solution, if we shouldn't look at possibly this particular, look at it on a per instance basis, whereas if you're off old Atlanta and your lot goes from 2/3 of an acre and they come in and now you've got 1/4 of an acre, they're leaving you with 1/4 of an acre.
Mm-hmm.
There's not much you can do with that. There's not much. What are you going to put on it now? It's non-conforming to whatever you have on there already. your setbacks are gonna be all messed up and everything because you've got a road right up to you. When is it a better practice to buy that lot?
And
for the good of the county, you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, but in condemnation, I would say that person can also say, look, you're devalue, if that person feels like that their use is being completely devalued, then they can contest the condemnation saying you need to buy the whole lot because it's no longer usable.
Yeah, that's when they come into play.
And they have to get two appraisals, and those appraisals have to kind of take into account that effect on the property value.
Well, and you may have a special master hearing, and you may have a jury trial that decides that where the homeowner.
But then are they paying for the legal fees to have representation for that? And are they paying for the appraisals and all of that just because of where their land is?
It's possible that the condemning authority, if they were in bad faith, could be made to pay for that.
I can ask the condemnation by sale or dedication. That's already something that's happening every day.
Sure.
Regardless of this, I can ask the legal staff to incorporate that into the presentation as well and talk about today, how does that work? Mm-hmm. How do they decide, what factors do they consider when they decide, do we take just what we need for the plans or do we take the whole thing, type question?
Well, normally, I've been in the eminent domain section of the bar for a while, but I'm not trying to give legal advice. I am saying, though, that you've got your temporary construction easement, you've got your permanent easements, you've got the amount you're actually taking. You may have easements for sewer lines or drainage lines or right across the people's property, too, so it all impacts and decreases the usability of the property. But if it's a condemnation or an arm's length negotiation with a knowledgeable owner, they're going to work out whatever their diminishing of value is. If it's somebody that has been asked by the county, we need this amount of land, and there's no lawyers involved, they may not realize some of the consequences of what they're giving up, and I don't know that the county has to inform them, but if it's in the code, then it protects them from that consequence.
And I feel like that it seems like there's a potential for it to be broader. I mean, I don't know, just the wording of it, it's limited to fee simple lot stuff, because it says that it's strictly the lot size, but I guess, to the power, to an entity with the power of condemnation, reduced by way of condemnation or by sale or dedication. I mean, there's a lot of things that get dedicated or sold, and the timing of those, whether something's planned or not planned, I just don't know if there's something that could be missed out of that. Like, say that you're able to count an open space area or something, and then you need to use it for infrastructure that you can then donate, and that way you're able to eliminate so much of your open space or something like that.
I just know that things like this have happened in the past where a change was made to take care of one particular problem, and then sometime later that change that was made caused additional problems.
Mm-hmm. If I look at this, I see it referring to lot size, which might deal with square footage of the lot. It doesn't seem to discuss specifically setbacks or things like that. But if in a zone there's a minimum lot size that is now you're going under that, maybe it could be viewed narrowly. I don't know, but there may need to be more guidance in the language as to what they mean by it.
Yeah, this is geared toward lot size. One of my first questions to legal staff when they sent the draft by me was, boy, this could be such a disaster if every project we develop, they're going to say, mm-hmm. 10 years ago I gave right away, so I don't want to put 89 trees in my parking lot, I want to put 82.
Right.
You guys got to do it. That's going to be just a heavy burden to figure out. And they said, well, I can't remember if they added this or if it was already there. They made it, it was already there, and they pointed it out maybe that, no, this is about lot size only.
And at the time of commencement of the use, that could be 30 years ago.
Do we allow private street subdivisions with a lot line in the center of the road?
You'll see that on lots done by an easement. And they could, and they pave it and they make it look just like a road. Typical larger neighborhood that gets developed, so they've got an access utility easement and the lots do not go to the center line.
Yeah, I mean, those are the ones that I usually see, are the ones that they define a right of way that's just gonna be probably maintained.
Looks just like a county road, but instead of being county right of way, it says an access utility easement.
Yeah.
Does that come up when something hasn't actually been platted? If it went through the normal plating process, would it clear up a lot of those things?
That, what Alan asked is more just an option people use when they want to have a gated neighborhood, or if it's a small scale subdivision that doesn't go through the plat, the final plat process, it goes through a minor plat.
Yes, where the center of the road would just become the.
And I guess I have a question for next Tuesday or before whatever our follow-ups are. If it's an option instead of changing the code to have it be for specific, you know, if there's some way to draft a legal document or something that everybody could sign that would say that in this situation, for this particular lot, you know, for tax parcel, whatever, that it is, you know, due to the circumstances involved, because this is obviously way outside of our normal, what we normally deal with. I mean, this isn't off of old Atlanta Road. This isn't off of Mullinax. This is in a area that will not remain this way forever. And, you know, I mean, hopefully we get sewer out there and we get roads and we be able to help these people actually, I mean, they need water. So I just wondered if we could do it, instead of it being a code change that changes it across the board for the entire county, is there some way legally, something that they, and I'm definitely no lawyer, so I don't know about this stuff very much, but that would be very specific to those specific lots that you are, because they are benefiting from what you're doing. In the situation where you're asking for them to donate right of way, or you're condemning for right of way, they're not benefiting from that really. In this situation, they're gaining something. They're gaining an actual road going to their property. You know? Does that make sense?
Yeah. I'll ask if could a variance accomplish it. A variance is the only thing I could think of.
Okay.
It couldn't be just some kind of contractual.
We could approve a variance though, because it could be voted on.
Yeah, it had to be something that has formal action.
But their use was lawful when it commenced. And should they need to apply for a variance with the risk that it wouldn't be approved, due to something that has happened later, at one way or the other, the behest of the county. You know, I think the idea of this is they shouldn't have to apply for the lot size variance. Now, if they want to build something because the lot size is smaller than it was and there's other code requirements, maybe they would need a variance then.
I think what?
The other problem is we don't allow variances to lot size.
We do in very limited circumstance. I'm not even sure this would fit in it.
Okay. So this might be the only solution for that particular area.
I'll check to see if a variance is, or some other thing. I'll ask them one more time, is it a variance or anything else possible?
Yeah, if the lot's unconforming, because say that we were talking about Highway 9, I'm just thinking about this. If the lot is non-conforming, say, whenever you're building the, or whenever they widen in the road, you know, that lot becomes non-conforming. That doesn't prevent its sale or use or anything. The trick here is that they want to subdivide based on their original lot lines, but the dedication of the road is going to be the problem. Is that correct? Because, I mean, we have lot lines that get dedication.
It's already subdivided, though. It's already subdivided. They're not,
Dedication of the road.
I think if they want to subdivide it again, they've got to use whatever rules are then existing. I think that's different. This is for somebody who's sitting in a house that was legal when it started, and now they've given up some of their land. They're not violating anything.
But what if they do want to subdivide again later?
Well, this one, first.
They have to start over.
This is in reference to repair, rebuilding, or altering.
Subparagraph C.
Damaging 50% or more of the structure. So this is only in that case where that condition applies, where they have to go in and alter the structure to.
Left, 10-2-3, C. So the only trigger for this is lightning strike, tree falls on it, burns down.
Yeah.
So it's quite specific.
Well, it's quite specific, but it will come up, especially along an older county road. There's a lot of.
There's still dirt roads.
Properties that'll end up potentially being non-conforming.
So we have the public hearing on this.
When people subdivide stuff, they subdivide it at the minimum required. Mm-hmm. So if you take a little bit off of it, all of a sudden it's not conforming.
But if they go to rebuild, Tom, they can't expand it. Is that the case? So if they were granted the ability, they're on a non-conforming lot. Let's say they experience damage. Mm-hmm. If they go to rebuild, though, can they enlarge their footprint on the now non-conforming lot?
No.
I didn't think so. So they're not going to be able to.
Okay. Not be enlarged, altered in any way.
A very different structure on it.
That's good then that you pointed out the one little subsection this applies to.
They can't change their, I guess they could repair, but they can't change the septic system either once it falls below an acre, can they? Is it 1 acre the minimum by the health department as well? For septic?
I'm not sure about that department.
I'm sure that's a different department relate to it, Alan, honestly. If it wasn't tied to a building permit, there's a pretty good chance this office would never even see it. Mm-hmm. Anyway, right. One's concerned about the section of the UDC, the health department's not.
Yeah, it's a different department. So
if it didn't trigger something on the health department's books, it would probably go right through.
So this will be a public hearing Tuesday night, is that correct?
That is correct.
Is there just one public hearing?
No, and in fact, the other one has already been advertised to go to the board at the beginning of May.
Okay, so there'll be two.
Okay.
Well, we'll see if people come out and have anything to say about it or understand it. I'm not sure I'll still understand it, but that's okay.
I will,
at this point.
I hear that, and by the fact that we talked about that for 15 or 20 minutes, I think is a good sign that I'll ask legal that try to have not only the things we talked about here before, but a presentation that kind of tries to a real simple description of what this is and what it's not. So even if we don't have any questions, people sitting there in the audience feel like they understand what we're talking about. So I'll ask if we'll put something together.
2014 calendar.
We had, of course, discussed the calendar earlier this year when it was adopted and talked about revisiting the holiday schedule. So I'm back to discuss that. Essentially, if the Planning Commission desires to cancel the December meeting, that is something that we do not have to go to a BOC work session to discuss. You can move forward with that. And also there was discussion for the November meeting of backing up the time of the work session. Right now it's 5:30, but there was concern that an hour between the work session and the public hearing wasn't enough time. So those would be the two items previously talked about that we can visit this evening.
Because we cannot go to November 11th for the work session and the 18th for the public hearing, correct?
On, all of this, the issue is quorums and looking at.
Well, but the work session, we don't, I mean, the 18th, the public hearing wouldn't change.
It would need to be, you know, I think I'd have to look at the bylaws for a minute. I don't know, maybe we went to the work session 2 weeks before the public hearing.
No, it's only 1 week before. It's just that we moved up.
I think the challenge last time, Vanessa, was could you do it that early in the month? Could you have a product ready?
But there's an issue with the board, too, because I was picking days where, I realize for the work session that's not important, but the days that you want then is the 11th instead of the 8th.
I mean, I don't know that we want that. I'm just asking as it, I'm asking for it just as an option, because I realize we wouldn't want to change any public hearings, because those are based on, you know, the Board of Commissioners having people there. We have to advertise. You have to have all the stuff, you know, all that stuff.
Tom is correct on this. It moves it to the point that we're really not going to be able to know that an application is ready for advertisement when we would have to back up the legal ad coming out so early that we're not going to be able to functionally get it on the.
So maybe that's a question that I have. What goes into preparing for our work session?
Well, it's the application has to be processed in that you generally are doing the legal ad has to often go in at the end of the previous month or at the very top end of the month because first of all, legal ads are due several days before it's advertised. Before it's even advertised, we have to do completeness checks. We have to make sure that all the provisions we've asked for.
So you're saying that's based on the agenda? I'm sorry.
Yes, what gets on your agenda means that this has to be properly advertised in time, and in order to know if it can be legally advertised in time, we have to have application checks, and that application goes through a series of steps to even know if we can submit it to the paper. And so we have to, you know, it has to be legally advertised 15 days, but then you not only have to count 15 days back from the public hearing, you then have to meet the ad submittal date. And in addition to that, we are processing 3 sets of applications at any one time. And so, I mean, I can go through how we process an application,
but I mean, I understand
so early,
that there's so many things to do for the public hearing. I just don't, I guess I'm confused as to why it would change anything for the work session, because we have, I mean, on our agenda today, there's stuff that's being postponed that's already been advertised, that's on the agenda. It's not changing anything that we, you know, I mean, it doesn't change how we discuss it or, you know.
We have to create the books. We then have to have the public participation reports in. That means that we have to rerun the staff reports. If we're doing it the 11th, that means that all of the tasks that we do prior to the work session, which is mainly ensuring that these applications are done, that public participation report that then would be due a week before the work session, that bumps it up for the applicant, and then that means we have to, they're not going to have nearly as much time for that particular month.
Okay, so it's better to wait to the 18th and only have a small window of time to discuss it before we go into the public hearing about it.
Change the time
that
of
was,
the work
that's
session.
What I heard the last time when we discussed this in January. The request from the Planning Commission was to back it up and not have it at 5:30, but do it at 4, do it at 4:30. This room would be available, so there's no reason why we cannot meet earlier.
You can start you can start the 6:30 meeting at 7, too, if you want. Is it accurate, Vanessa, that when we're putting together the agenda for this meeting, we're only putting things on the calendar that have completed the staff review and been and are justified and been sent to the paper?
Correct.
Yeah.
It's an informalized.
We don't. The applicants won't submit to us till the 17th, and all the other departments that review typically have about 2 weeks to review, and we wouldn't even have 2 weeks before we'd have to send them the paper, so we wouldn't have. We wouldn't have decided yet what was going to be on the agenda
to
do it, and that's why. It's one of the main reasons.
Yes, absolutely. The work session, although we're just discussing it, is a set agenda. These things are not maybe they're ready, maybe they're not.
Okay.
The only time things get knocked off is they
through postponements for either they haven't submitted something or the applicant wants them.
So I guess first we need to talk about November.
The concern with the 25th, obviously, is that is school out that entire week for Thanksgiving. I'm not in tune with our school schedule.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
I don't really understand why we always, and we've done it this way the last 2 years, so this isn't a new thing, but for some reason in November we take off that whole week, but then in December we schedule meetings for December the 30th.
That is because a lot of this has to do with the Board of Commissioners and their schedule.
The board does not want a meeting during Christmas. It's Christmas or New Year's, one gets mm-hmm. hit. So, and that is why the discussion is up for potentially canceling the December meeting. But we take essentially the lesser of the the two undesirable dates and generally.
Well, and in December, I understand, but I'm saying we do it in December, but in November, we say we're not going to meet the whole week of Thanksgiving, even though Thanksgiving's really only the Thursday.
School is out Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
It is.
Week. Is that good, right?
A lot of people go out of town. And I think with the public hearing,
well,
that's
what
the concern
is.
Well,
what I don't have,
which
I need to get, is
well,
the notes
have
I took
to have
at
a
the work session.
No, I know. It's not you, because I know exactly. I was at that work session, and they said they didn't want to have a meeting during that week. I'm just suggesting that it's kind of odd to say, oh, well, we're just going to take off the whole week of November for the whole week of Thanksgiving, even though it's just a one-day thing. But in December, you need to be here to have a meeting, a public hearing, when no public's going to be here. I mean,
yeah, it was January 2nd this year, and almost nobody was there.
At the Board of Commissioners, absolutely.
Yeah.
So what's the pleasure of the board? What would you all like to do about the November and the December meeting? Which one would you like to do first? It sounds to me like your preference would be to cancel the December 30th meeting. So my suggestion is that we take that on first. That seems to be relatively simple.
Well, and the only reason I think we should cancel it is because it's very hard for citizens to get there, and
I agree with that.
We may all be there and have every intention of being there, but when we get email, I mean, we got emails last year about it, and people were very upset, right? And I felt rightfully so, because it's people are out of town, it's a family time, the kids are out of school. I totally get it.
So would you like to make a motion to cancel the
I would
December
like to make a motion
meeting?
To cancel the December 30th meeting.
I'll second that. Is there any discussion?
Is the 16th off the table? If we do want to have a December meeting, is it worth having it? Again, I'm not in tune with when school's out and stuff like that, but if we were to do it kind of the week before
Christmas. You're
running
Christmas,
into the same problem.
We
run
can't.
Into the
yeah.
same
right.
times.
Then
I'm saying
December 9th.
It will be 16th.
It's
right?
a public hearing, but then you're talking about...
I'm saying if we were to double up again.
To double up, the 16th.
It was because of the conflict with the commissioners
mm-hmm.
the last when
yeah.
when they discussed their meeting, that's why Vanessa didn't do that.
So their meeting is December 18th.
Right, because their meeting is December 18th. And their work session, they have a work session, I believe, on the 16th as well. Something like that.
So we have a motion and a second on the table.
Schedule here.
Something like that.
To cancel the meeting on December 30th. Any more discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion to cancel the December 30th work session and Planning Commission meeting passes 5-0. Okay, now let's move to November. From the discussion, it sounds to me like we may want to have an earlier work session instead of what's scheduled at 5:30, perhaps 4 or 4:30. At 4:30, that would give us 2 hours before. If we had it at 4, it would give us 2.5 hours before we had the public hearing.
I heard Mr. Brown say something about 7 o'clock instead of 6:30. Was that what you were referring to here?
Right, you're public hearing, you're not, you could bump that back. Let's do a combination. Move one earlier and one later.
Still like keeping the public hearing at 6:30, just because that's what people expected. I mean, people otherwise might show up and wonder if it was canceled.
Yeah, they don't check schedules, they just know that the Planning Commission public hearing is always at 6:30.
Well, and I think that's the benefit of moving it back as opposed to moving it forward. I wouldn't recommend moving it forward. Starting at 5, if something weird was going on.
Sure.
You move it back, and you have a sign on the door saying tonight starts at 7.
Well, we would be here with doing the work session.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, what's the pleasure of the board? What would you all like to do? Somebody can make a motion.
I would move that we start the work session at 5 and the meeting at 7 on the 18th.
Is there a second?
I'll second it.
Is there discussion?
Is 5 early enough? Do we want to leave a little bit of time between the work session and the public hearing to, you know, use the restroom, get all of our stuff back up there, have a glass of water?
That's 2 hours total if we did the other at 7.
It's now
5 and 7. That's what
7:30. So we've been here for an hour.
Our cases don't usually take as long as the discussions before, though.
If we're just cases. Yeah. So we just need to not put anything else on the agenda besides the cases.
Not to mention, if there's not going to be time, like the week span between that and the public hearing, I think a lot of them will go through. We'll mention one thing, and we'll be like, well, we'll find out in the public hearing.
And we'll also know that we have this time limit. And it makes a difference when you know that you have that time limit.
Yeah, I just know that when we go through all of these, we send Vanessa with like a whole list of things to do, and that there's no time for that in this situation. So we're definitely, you know, just going with it at that point.
For the extra hour, we do that time either. Mm-hmm. I mean, Vanessa couldn't answer those questions, so.
Yeah. You could send in any questions.
Prior to.
Okay. Vanessa, from your perspective, it's impossible to even have a, because I found the time between the work session and the public hearing to be valuable to reconnect with people, finalize conversations, all that kind of stuff, even my one time doing this, and you guys may feel differently, but is it viable to have a Thursday or Friday work session the week before? Is anything prior to the 18th just make it impossible for you guys?
Doing it that second, you know, when we're talking about moving it up to the first agreement, that second week, it is extraordinarily difficult for us.
I will say normally this time of year is slower than other times of the year. It may not be this year since I've said that, announced it early that it usually is, but.
And this, the canceling December, I assume, puts more things on the agenda here that would bump up against 100 days that we'll hear in November that we may have not heard until December, but we'll have to.
We'll have to hear it in November.
Because we're not, we're losing essentially.
Because that happened this year with us, in that we had a decision that we couldn't make, we couldn't vote on, because it had to go just straight to the commissioners without a recommendation. Because of, I'm not sure if it was because of the December meeting or if it was because then the January meeting was canceled, but one of those things happened, and we could not. We heard the public hearing, and we postponed the decision, I believe, and then that meeting was canceled, so then it had to go on.
On that subject, with postponements run calendar days, so if we have things that are running out at that time frame, November meeting, and they run past that, they can run past that limit by December, right?
That's right, and we will, you know, and as I mentioned in my email, we're going to mark that 100th day now.
Yeah, I saw that.
100 days, you'll know potentially how many times you can postpone.
Okay.
Very helpful.
Thank you.
So we have a motion and a second to have the work session from...
Start at 5.
To start at 5, and then the public hearing would start at 7 on November 18th.
Guys, one last question. What's our ability at the last minute to move a work session time? In other words, if we find that we're loaded up, is this, how set in stone is this decision at the moment?
It's pretty set because of all the other things.
We adopt the calendar. If there was going to be another change, we would need to, you know, formally change it, but that's...
If
it's just going to be once the legal ad goes out, of course, it's done.
If we saw it coming October 14th because there was a lot of stuff in the pipeline, could we make that decision then?
We could always change.
October
21st. The idea was to move early, even though we're very early for the holiday schedule.
Yeah.
Certainly, I think that, you know.
At that point, we could change it again.
That's great.
Okay. So we have a motion and a second. Is that it for discussion? All those in favor of the motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion passes 5-0 to have the work session from 5 to 7, to start at 5 on November 18th, and to have the public hearing start at 7 on November 18th.
I will go ahead. I will republish the calendar. It will be posted. And I just wanted to give you a few highlights on the next three upcoming work sessions in May. Kim is going to be coming next month for doing a training. We're also going to be reviewing the short-term work program. So this is an annual activity that the Planning Commission looks at as far as policy and code changes that we would like to work on for next year, but also the next 5 years. In June, there will be a discussion from engineering on stormwater, and we will be revisiting the staff report and revisions to that time. And then in July, engineering will be giving a presentation on transportation issues.
May is short-term work.
Yes. And I will be sending that out early in May, so you'll have time to review the work session.
I don't know why I'm writing this on here. I won't be able to keep up with it. Meeting minute review.
There were three changes to the March meeting minutes. These should be in your folder. I'll just go through them. The top of page 5, towards the top under adoption of minutes, there is clarification on the adoption date for the February 25th meeting minutes to clarify that Greg abstained from adoption. Also on page 7, with it to the top, right above the public hearings for home occupation permits, there was clarification that Greg opposed this particular motion. And then on page 9, under CA 3670, Kathy or Losky, there was the addition of the word to rezone from single family residential. The word from was not inserted. So those are the changes made to the minutes that you will consider for adoption next Tuesday.
On the minutes issue, I've heard from Jane twice at meetings that some of the conditions that have come out in our meetings didn't seem to be showing on the screen at the actual Board of Commissioners meetings. And I know that when they had the 20 acres versus 10 acres, that wasn't conveyed to the commission until we brought it up right there at the meeting. And so...
Well, as far as policy, what happens is whatever you adopt, which is why we do the review, this gets
the actual minutes on a particular case are inserted in a memo that goes directly to the board. So the board is aware of who spoke at the meeting and the motion. So what is reflected in the minutes that are in your folder should be going up to the board directly.
But that isn't what I'm talking about. As the conditions at the BOC meeting were being displayed, new things that we had put in, and you pointed out on two occasions, two different nights, were not in that screen thing that was being shown to the commissioners, and so
I don't know what's being shown on the screen.
I can speak to that.
Yeah.
The product that leaves the Planning Commission is provided to the Board of Commissioners. It's put in their books, but NBASA sends it up to them. And we also put it on the network drive for that night when the staff showed on the screen. It's put on the screen. Now, if an individual commissioner wants something else shown because they've been working on the rezoning, they feel like they've made progress and have a new version of the conditions, they replace the Planning Commission's proposal with a more updated version, and that's what's shown on the screen. So whenever you don't see what came from the Planning Commission on the screen, it's because the commissioner making the motion, or the commissioner that anticipates they're going to make the motion, feels like they've picked up the Planning Commission's product and continue to work it and continue to evolve it. And I do think you're not the first Planning Commissioner that's mentioned that to me. I do think it's confused people in the past. I can tell you this, it may not be directly this issue, but at Tuesday's work session, the next Board of Commissioners work session, they have an agenda item about zoning conditions. And I was actually just talking about this same issue with Commissioner Boff this morning about what exactly that discussion is going to be on Tuesday and how it relates to the issue you just brought up. So I think he'd heard that from you.
Yeah, I talked with him. Yeah.
And I anticipate there's a pretty good chance that the discussion will go that direction at some point to talk about what's being shown on the screen and is there a way to, you know, show a redline version of the Planning Commission's product as opposed to just a replacement of the Planning Commission's product. There are a lot of different options that all, I think, sound pretty easy at first. Then you get into the details of the timing of it all. They get a little complicated. So I'm not sure what where the board will settle in the end. But as for right now, there's a very good chance it's going to be talked about by our elected officials in just a matter about a week from now.
Okay. Review and discussion of application schedule for public hearing on April 22nd.
The first conditional use permit that will have to be postponed, the public hearing sign affidavit was not submitted by the deadline.
Do we need to worry about the 100 days with this one? This has been going on for a really long time, but it's always changed because of something that wasn't submitted.
Yeah, that's been July. It hadn't been submitted for a long time.
It would be July. He would be fine until July.
He went a long time before it would get his report.
He's been stuck in applicant work time for a very long time, but the 100 days doesn't start until that public participation report is submitted. So you can hang out in applicant work time 180 days, and
that's why it just seems like it's been going on forever.
Sure.
Okay. 3642 Home South Communities. And you said that cannot be postponed because of the 100 days, is that correct? Well, Commissioner Delazal,
we discussed this at the last meeting as well. Jane was working on this before I was appointed and met with homeowners and develop some conditions, and I believe that those have been circulated. If not, I can pass those around to you and open to any feedback before then, but I think we're prepared to hear what everybody has to say and move forward with this one.
I have a couple of questions just about, since it's been going on for so long, I went back and looked at it again just to refresh my memory. I'm going to have a couple of questions in regards to the Board of Education report that we get. It is my understanding that we just received the report, pasted in here where it belongs. That comes from Tim Emerson, is that correct?
What he sends is a spreadsheet with numbers, and then we have a text template, basically.
But I mean, he gives that information.
That is correct.
Okay, so my first question, and this will have to go to him, I guess, is why does the number that we, the multiplier, why does it change? So for instance, on this one, 3642, it's 0.6 per household. But like,
they just changed it, I think, for the reason for that.
On, well, but we've got on this one, on 3663, it's 0.648. Then on 3674, I think, it's 0.5.
Oh, wow.
It, on 3674, it's 0.545. So I get the jump from the 0.6 to 0.648. I don't get why we go back down to 0.545 in the 3674.
I thought the jump that I saw was to 0.7 something most recently.
None of these in this book are 0.7, just as an FYI. The other question I have about the school, the Board of Education report, is where do we get the information on the school's opening and the funding approved?
That is from Tim as well.
That's specifically from him.
Yes,
so
we don't provide any analysis of the school information.
Okay.
We simply,
so I'll have to ask him how
and
why
say,
it's not the same.
Mm-hmm. And he's not at our meetings typically. So do you want us to, are you going to contact him between now and next week, or do you want us to contact him with these questions?
Which do you prefer?
You contact him tomorrow.
Okay. If you can contact him and just ask for an explanation about why, because for a while they were all exactly the same. There was no funding available. Now we've got different openings for schools. Now on this one it says elementary school 14, middle school 10, and high school not applicable, no funding approved. But then on 3663 it states that the future elementary, middle, and high schools are planned, but funding has only been allocated for the elementary school.
Okay, so on both.
Then
there's differences.
It's just,
is it just,
it would be really good for us if this, there was some
there
consistency.
Well, what's, yeah, and mm-hmm. if there's a difference, why do we have that? You know, I mean, this one, the next one is the same as the second one I mentioned, but then it changes again to where there's a middle school approved for funding, and it's just very confusing. So if they could figure that out, that'd be great. We are constantly getting the when it's in the Big Creek watershed at the 25 impervious surface limitation. I know this can't be answered tonight, but if we could at some point, maybe in the whole stormwater thing, give us a better explanation of if it's not calculated based on the particular property, how do we calculate it? And
it's countywide, isn't it?
And how are we get, where are we given that information, and how do we know, how do we determine, well, it's not, I mean, how do we determine when all of a sudden we hit 25, because it says we haven't, but when we all of a sudden we do hit 25%, then we're just not allowed to sell any more properties in that watershed? Who determines that? That doesn't seem fair to landowners. It doesn't, you know, it's just, it's very vague. So I would like some more information on that.
You've had this come up before, so now you can explain it.
Ah, okay, so in, on that same 3642, in the criterion section, on section criterion number 4, it says the proposed residential rezoning will result in the use that is, could cause excessive burden, which is on every single one that we have in here. It gives further explanation on the Board of Education side, where it now says future elementary and middle schools are planned, but the timeline is unavailable. So if they're planned, is that from the bond that we think we're gonna plan it? Or is that just because we bought property? Or, you know, it just seems, I just didn't understand. On the criterion number 2, this one is very short and limited in its explanation of adjacent and nearby properties. It never references the Res 4 property that's directly across the street from this property. And the A1 property across the street is a church. So I don't know, you know, on several of the other ones, it's a very good detailed criterion number 2, which gives lot size and density, and that one just has that one sentence basically not really explaining much at all. I went in to look and find out the lot sizes and density and all that, but you know, and I don't mind doing that, I just didn't understand why it would be different from report, you know, from each individual report. And that might have been something to do with the timing of the report or when it was prepared.
I think it was when it was prepared, frankly. This application was submitted in July, right at the time that Teresa left.
Okay.
So there has been, you know, a training.
Okay.
Knows,
sure.
Training evolved during
okay.
the summer. So
sure.
I think some of that would be due to it, but certainly the school questions, I've never written
yeah.
down
right.
and outlined.
Okay.
I would say the criteria questions are more related to when this information was inputted by
okay.
staff. So.
Those are my questions on that one.
And the BNP.
The BNP, you told me yes, but I did not know what that was.
So Pam referenced you asked some information on the water centers that way briefly.
We'd like to actually, if we could come back.
Talk about
that
when we're talking about water. Mm-hmm. Great.
Okay, so this will be ready then to move forward for public hearing.
That's correct.
Anybody else have anything on that? If not, we'll move on to 3662, which is Shallow Garnett. I think this also is in district.
Three.
It
is. Shallow Garnett is having, they're still working on their second entrance issue, and they're going to be resubmitting parts of their application that will restart the clock on their 100 days.
So they're basically refiling it?
They will, yes.
But we don't have official word on that yet?
We've received it verbally, but I've not received it in writing. Have you received any new documentation on this?
I don't believe so.
Okay.
Sure. Would they sound like they're going to be turning it in? New site plan? Or?
Yes. Relative to, they have acknowledged they need to sort out the second entrance, and they're going to resubmit something. I think that they'll be probably selected what they submit that will restart the clock for them because they need more time to sort out the second entrance.
Does that mean they have to start the whole process all over again? I don't know.
If they resubmit to us, we would have to re-review it, and so.
So it would start with zoning review. Even before that.
With a new entrance, we're going to. So
do we have
yes.
to,
likely, yes.
do they have to withdraw without like ask for a withdrawal?
It's up to, and that's it's good we got to this topic, is if you're working with an applicant and you want them to resubmit something and you think it's the best option to resubmit, let me know about that, because once it's been advertised for a public hearing, any changes to the file are at my discretion. Honestly, I'm pretty stingy about it. A lot of times my answer is no. should have applied for something.
You sent me an email about that, about whether submitting more stuff would cause a restart or not.
On the 100 days, too, yeah.
But they can withdraw without prejudice and then resubmit without discretion.
Without prejudice, they'd have to go to the planning, or the Board of Commissioners to ask for that, or the Planning Commission?
They would have to ask you at the public hearing, and you can grant them to be without prejudice, but they have to wait and ask if they want to withdraw prior to the public hearing. Now that's been advertised, it will be with prejudice.
Okay, so.
So I don't, if you're working with one, though, and you want them to resubmit something, we can make it happen. Just if you let me know, then I can anticipate when it's coming in.
Then it's a mutual understanding.
So can you explain just quickly what the difference is between them withdrawing with prejudice and us voting to withdraw without prejudice? How does that change it for them?
It would change it based on when they can resubmit. So the UDC clearly outlines that if something is withdrawn with prejudice, they can't turn around and reapply. Yes, they have to wait 12 months.
Yeah, if it gets denied, there's a waiting period as well, right?
There is a waiting period as well.
Before any application can resume.
Right.
Or denied, it's the same. If it's denied or withdrawn, yes.
Before we leave the topic, why I don't always accept changes to applications? Two things. One, I want applicants to really ask the Planning Commission for something that they think is realistic. And I don't want a system in place where ask for this, even though I'm happy with that, and if I get any turbulence, then I'll just drop back and go with plan B. I don't want that to be our system. And number two, sending one back is more work for the staff than starting a new one. So we have to do everything over, and we have to clean up everything that's already been done and close it out. And we don't typically get any new fees for that other than the advertising fee, which is $20 or something. But for the countless hours of staff time, we don't get anything, so it's not a good spend. There's not an appropriate fee for it we have in place right now. So between those two reasons,
how do you fix that?
The commissioner.
Fees, yeah, the commissioners adopt our fee schedule. We'd have to take it to them to get a fee for it.
Oh, in a situation like this, we've got they thought the product was good. They thought they were giving you a good development. They realized once they got, it had been pretty much slated to have the two entrances. When they got in and saw that it wasn't going to work out, I feel like there needs to be some way for them to be able to hold off, pull back from it, mm-hmm. make a good, educated, well thought out decision and come back with something new that's viable. Because at this point, it's not even viable. I mean, they can't do anything with it right now because the entrance is just not going to work out. So it seems very restrictive on our part that we're just saying, cool, too bad, you can't do it. You're going to be out 12 months.
I think that the applicant on this one's kind of getting beat up too, because the engineering department is saying tie to these roads, and then you have the people in the neighborhood that are saying we don't want it tied in, and what's going to end up happening is they're not going to get the zoning because you're trying to do what staff's telling you have to do, mm-hmm. you need to do there. And I mean, I would agree, they need some connectivity there. So it makes it tricky if that's not going to do.
Well, we don't say no. I don't say no at all. I talked with someone today who wants to bring one in, and I said, if you bring in, a good reason why, we'll consider it and we'll possibly move forward. So it's not always a no.
So then if they bring in a new one, then it goes back to how many more days do they have?
It's most likely go all the way back to staff review. Right?
And most likely they would have to attend the zoning review meeting.
Again, okay.
Depending on the situation, of course, they've already missed the deadline, so you're looking at probably June.
Well, that's fine. Sending them back a month or two isn't a
big difference from 12.
Absolutely. I mean, that's a whole nother cycle if you go 12 months. But to set it back a couple of months, I think, is reasonable. But I also think it's important that that there be a fee structure there that can, that doesn't necessarily put y'all in a situation where you're just expending great amounts of time because people are resubmitting, you know?
If we haven't had many of them historically, that's been one of the reasons why we've never bothered really to ask for a fee, because it just hasn't come up that often in a long time. If we start to see, you know, more consistent, where we're seeing a half dozen of them a year, I think it, I would go upstairs and talk about it from a fee standpoint.
Okay.
If we do just, you know, if it's still just one or two a year, for right now, I'd say we've got a long list of stuff to tackle, and I'd tackle a lot of things first. So I'll keep an eye on it. If we see a lot of them, I will bring it up.
Anybody have anything else to add on that? Next is 3663.
This is going to actually go back to zoning review due to the need to put a stream on the site plan, which has emerged. We're in the Planning Commission that we're instituting a new process that's just beginning with this, the main round of zoning review. We will be, engineering will have a site field verification of state waters at the rezoning stage, which has not been implemented before, so we're basically working on integrating that process now with a new round of applications, but this one will be going back to zoning review due to state waters.
What's the reason this one's subject to it?
There is a stream not currently shown on the site plan.
Okay, so you go back and check.
There hasn't been a verification of that. We're not going back and doing field checks on the ones now. We're instituting this in the process. This particular one, the applicant came to us and wishes to amend the site plan.
Okay.
So we will have to go back through staff and review.
That's good to know.
So we won't have to vote on this, right? We just make the announcement?
Well, we officially, we just got a phone call late this afternoon about this issue, so we need to hear, you know, officially from the applicant in writing that they will be resubmitting materials.
Okay, so as long as you get that in writing by next Tuesday, the announcement will be as being resubmitted.
Yes.
Okay.
We'll amend it back to staff.
Then if that happens, we don't have to vote on it? Is that correct?
That's right. Agenda will need to be amended at the
And that'll restart their 100 days. Well, I mean, they'll restart the whole process.
It'll start, okay. Yes, exactly.
Will there be a note up on the agenda online for people who look so that they might have some clue
right
that
now,
maybe...
Right now, nothing's official, so I can't put it in the summary. Tomorrow in the summary, James Sharp's postponement will be announced, but until we get something in writing from the applicant, there's nothing that we can do officially.
I believe this is District 3 as well.
Yes. This is a property, we talked about this briefly last month. It's a 297 lot request on Mullinax Road. The applicant had agreed to postpone it to meet with some of the concerns surrounding property owners, set up a meeting. Probably my mistake for setting up on a Friday night because one out of the five showed up. They are actually going to request a postponement again to continue some of that dialogue that we weren't able to have, and also to continue some of the dialogue that we did have there that evening. I mentioned this at the last meeting, there's a lot of things that I personally am excited about with this development. There's some concerns that have been expressed that we're going to hopefully work through, get everybody on the same page and be able to move forward with this. So, I don't know if everybody's had a chance to look at this, but it's got varying lot sizes. It's got 7 acres of green space. So it's got a lot of things like that that I think we've been asking developers to do. The flip side of that is this in an incredibly overcrowded elementary school district, and currently on a overcrowded road that will be, hopefully, John Kennard confirmed by 2016, uncrowded, which I'm excited about because I live on, over there. So those are the things that we've talked about and continue to have dialogue about.
So the main concern of the citizens is that is with the school? Is that what you're finding?
There's the concern with the school. There's an overall, from one group in particular, just they'd like to see the density slightly lower. And, you know, we talked with the applicant, there's two sides of that. One, you're bringing a quality product in, and that may allow them to do the extra 15 houses that they're talking about, may allow them to do that versus not allow them to do that. So, you know, that's both sides, I think, on that have valid arguments, valid concerns. But the schools is a hot button. That school is, it's an older school. Midway, which is right on Highway 9. And so that's from the Shepherd's Pond folks, and from the folks up and down kind of the Mullinax corridor. That was their concern. There's some concern from Longwood folks about traffic. And, you know, that is what it is. There will be a second entrance on Fowler Road. And the Longwood representative that we invited to that meeting did not make it. So hopefully we're able to set something else and hear more clarity from them.
And staff, according to their staff analysis and everything, is supported.
Correct.
Do we have the ability to condition timing on this so that it actually creates the additional population at a time when there's a school solution, so that it's, and I don't know that we do, but how will we deal with the fact that there may not be a school available when kids start moving in there? Because there's a long term, maybe it would be more desirable long term than short term. What do you think about that?
Right. I think part of the reason that they are wanting to wait is to see what does happen with the school referendum. That I think will give some clarity as to where we're at with the entire county, with the future of our school funding.
I don't know how we can just, I mean, it seems difficult to me, and, you know, with my connection to the school, I have lots of strong desires for the schools to be great.
But you also have insight.
I do, but I don't know that I can give you insight from the school perspective. I just don't know that we can legally, in our role, say, I mean, well, you're just never going to be able, you're not going to be able to develop this property until the school system can build us some schools. We don't even know when that could be. The general population could say, no, we don't want to pay for school, so we're going to vote down the bond referendum. And then what do we do? It's not the fault of the landowners that the schools are crowded. They didn't, how do you say you just can't sell your land?
Well, you can't. And
anymore. And trust me,
if you wanted to put your house up for sale, we came to you and said, well, I'm sorry, but you really can't sell your house right now because we don't want that to happen.
Right, so I think there are some, there are things in place right now that are that's slowing some of our, some of the decisions and stuff that we're making. It doesn't go through fast. We postpone things. We're changing it to make it as good as possible. But just legally, this is not my preference. It's just legally, I don't really know how you would.
I mean, I don't either.
I don't know how you would implement that onto someone in a legal way.
There are municipalities that have adequate public facility ordinances. I don't know if there's any in Georgia. I don't know that our state laws allow for it. I've wondered myself, being honest and transparent, when the UDC says one thing we are to consider is schools and roads, what does that mean relative to what Pam just said? And I don't. That's a question that I guess humbly put before you guys for your input on.
To me personally, and this is based on our discussion with Ken that we had last year, and our discussion with Tim from the school, from Board of Education, was that we were that was a, something that we can consider, but it doesn't dictate. And in considering, I think we do that regularly where we do encourage them to decrease the density. And we do try to, you know, we are more lenient on developments that are age restricted in a community that has a very high population of children because our schools are overcrowded. So that's like a way of, you know, of working on that. I just don't know how we could legally dictate a timeline when we have no control over, and the landowners have no control over, and the developers, nobody has any control over what the school system does.
Unless the school system was going to sign some sort of an agreement that they would provide services at a certain time frame, which
right.
of course then that could put them in trouble.
Right.
Yeah, I mean then that could possibly put the school system in trouble though if they don't have funding because they committed a commitment.
That cycle.
What is state? I don't know, but the state law as far as providing school services, is the school system required to provide services in a certain manner? That may sound silly. I mean, it's probably yes, but.
I believe yes. Is that a good enough answer?
They're required to provision of trailers, correct?
They're required to provide a classroom for every student and an educational opportunity for every student.
A seat. Legally obligated.
What did Tim call them? Cottages?
Learning cottages.
Learning cottages, yes.
And I will say we've been through this before. I mean, when I moved here, 141 was a two-lane road. It was backed up for an hour to get to 400. Now I can get there in 8 minutes, you know, because they widened the road because it was so overcrowded that they came out and widened the road. Big Creek Elementary was full of trailers. There was a trailer on every inch of property on that, you know, that the school was sitting on. Now, there's not enough kids in it to fill it because we have to move the kids over this direction. You know what I mean? So it's been going on for a while here. And
circles.
They'll catch up. I mean, in 2009, we built 5 schools. So.
Yeah, and part of the problem with their funding is it's based on a 5-year average, their federal funding. And we had some bad years where they didn't get the federal funding that they had been previously, and that average is based on those bad years. So it hasn't caught up yet to where they would get additional federal funding like they had before. So it's a combination of a lot of things that have happened.
And in this property, in terms of your timeline, I think if I'm reading this correctly, where Mullinax is presently and where it will be, they're changing that curve. So they wouldn't be able to put the houses along there until later. It would be what I would envision it, because right now the road basically comes in. Like it's a pretty sharp S-curve there, right. And so they're gonna smooth it out a little bit, so all of that will have to be done before they can
right.
put
and,
any
and it'll take them a while to put their infrastructure in
right.
anyhow and go through the
right.
the other permitting processes and things.
There's not a great solution that I see.
I mean, on the flip side, say that you have a smaller population, you don't necessarily want to bear the tax burden of building a bunch of improvements with a smaller population
mm-hmm.
to try and provide for future growth, because then you're paying more up front in facilities that you're not using and with less people. So I mean, it seems like it's naturally following behind because you don't want to spend that money up.
Well, Fayette County did the same thing. Fayette County built all these new schools to prepare for the growth that was definitely coming. And now they've closed, I think, 7 mm-hmm. of those. They're just empty school buildings that they've had to close down. And what do you do with the school when you can't use it? I mean, they're just gonna sit there vacant. It costs a lot of money to run the schools. So, you know, they thought that they were preparing
for something that just never came.
Do you know whether this is going to be developed in phases or all at once, or how does that work? Because it would make a big difference.
It's going to be developed in phases from the standpoint that they've got a certain amount of homes that they can finance.
Right.
But they are going to be building basically a couple of each product initially. And I think they're going to, because I've asked them a lot of questions about what do you think about this lot size versus that lot size, and what's your impression of where this product's going to land? And you know, they've talked about the pro formas, and I believe that 5 years, 4 to 5 years, is their target to be done. Mm-hmm. And obviously, they'd like that to be as fast as they can. They like to, you know, for the market to support that.
Yeah, so but if it's spread out over 5 years, that makes a difference, because there could be a school by
there's then. The landowner, this is a 150-acre tract, and he's planning on living there while development is happening, because where his house is not where the initial homes are going to be built. So they're going to be building, I wouldn't call it phases from the standpoint that this is going to open up and then that's going to open up, right. But they're going to be building gradually relative to just the fact they're not going to build 300 houses at one time.
It might be helpful if some of that's explained at the public hearing.
Yeah, I mean, the time frame from zoning approval to the time that the first person gets their certificate of occupancy or can buy a home, I mean, that's usually 12 to 18 months from the time that it gets zoned to, because you've got about, you know, at least 3 or 4 months to ever get to breaking ground, but then having to build roads, then going through the platting process.
And that's if you're being really speedy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, that 18 months is an aggressive schedule.
So we're just waiting on a written request from
this. Yeah, I actually sent an email today and asked if they still plan on requesting a postponement, and they said that they are.
So, and then we'll vote on that.
Correct.
All right. Anything else on this one? 3671 is Ridgeline. Commissioner Neal. We've now left District 3 and moved on to District 4.
Oh, we'll come back.
Yeah. Yeah. I believe the applicant's going to ask about having this one postponed. I know that there's some waters concerns on this one, which I've
sewer as well, right?
Yeah, I believe sewer and water both are issues on this one. But I believe the mainstream is shown, but there's some beavers as well down there. Not bad.
Keep going back to the beavers.
So you believe that this is going to have a request for postponement also?
That's my understanding, is that there probably will be.
But there is a real problem.
Well, there's that and sewer challenges. I think that they're still trying to work out and verify that they're going to be able to get those. And then trying to figure out exactly what the waters are down there. This was a prior one. This one's not going to be walked, right? This one won't be walked,
right? No,
right?
No.
Yeah.
Can we request that it be?
The issue would be the timing. The way we've got it now is that Sonda needs quite a bit of time. In fact, we will not have this verification. It'll come in. What's going to happen is the applicants will have a quick turnaround time for work submittal. And that's just because if we get up, say we got up to 8 or 10 applications in a given month, I figure that would be the absolute maximum. He needs 4 weeks to be able to schedule everything with his other responsibilities.
What's the issue with the sewer?
The issue is there's nothing around there, I think.
It's in the city.
No, I don't think.
I think it just stays that it's in the city service area. I haven't seen it actually set by the location.
I think sewer's far away. So I don't know that they can do much until it gets closer.
Yeah, there's a water main, but then sewer's not there.
Huge water main, but there's a smaller water main too. So they don't have to tie into that one.
The project is gonna, the city of Cumming indicates what the project's gonna require and in their letter right behind the application.
They have a fee tied to that?
Yeah.
$425,000. To reserve the required capacity.
So that's just the tap fees, pretty much.
Once sewer capacity is assigned, the capacity.
Yeah, the county.
The owner developer shall be prepared to make a significant contribution towards the installation of sewer infrastructure in the setting down creek drainage basin. The city will not agree to allow this parcel to be serviced by a septic system. So they have to pay to have sewer out there by the city.
Well, there'd be a cost of an extension to it, you know, then any easement, whatever that is. And then the tap fees, which the tap fees are like you pay a share of the treatment plant upgrades so that, you know, sewer plants cost a lot of money to build. And so that's kind of their impact fee, is they get that cost for it. So sometimes it goes partially to treatment and partially to the distribution system.
What's the density on this? I'm seeing two different numbers.
When's the 100-day on this one?
July.
Until June.
0.04.
June?
Yes.
2.45.
If the last possible, it'll be next month. It would have to be next month.
2.49. So the applicant.
See that this one.
What's that would be? What do you have?
I need to grab that and check.
You have 2.04 on page 3?
Yeah.
2.04 on the application, 2.49 on the tech review, staff review.
And the plat is.
And the plat, yeah.
2.485. The application seems to be wrong.
Well, the application is, I see what we got initially. And then the 2.485.
They rounded up.
Yeah, they rounded up.
Right. For the 2.04 on page 3.
Good. Just the, maybe an error they had at the beginning of the application that was not refiled. We didn't receive an update on that, so we can get an update. But, their new site plan does indicate 2.485.
I have a couple of questions, Tom. One would be that the rule about being within a mile of sewer, does that extend to both the city and the county sewer service areas? I mean, these are really just questions for my information.
The I'd have to connect to sewer if it's a mile away.
Mm-hmm.
One thing about this would be slightly different is that we can't do septic on a rest area doesn't allow septic at all.
Right.
But how does it relate to the city? Well, I haven't come across that one in a while.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I think we honestly we started off with the same requirement. But we need to check.
Okay.
Hold on so long. I'll make a note of that and get you an update.
I was just curious. I mean, I know it isn't coming up, but if it did come up, I just wondered about, you know, their service areas or they have service areas inside of the county, and does the county's regulation apply to the county property or does it apply to the county service area? it's written in our UDC, so isn't it so?
And I think we've even had more confusion. One time we had it, they were just outside the city's district. Sewer was in the city's district, and they were, you know, 200 feet away, but outside the service area. And that one, we said, no, that doesn't, we're not going to count that as being within the distance because they can't serve you outside their district. Within their district, I think it would be the same, but I want to double check that.
Okay. The other question I was going to ask, I think I know the answer to this, is there's nothing that would say we couldn't rezone this to Res 3, but it could never be platted or built without having sanitary sewer.
That's right.
I mean, there's not really a reason to compel to want to zone something that doesn't have sewer service, but I was just trying to think, we're really, our job is still looking at the land use, so say that it does come up next month, it doesn't mean that if it doesn't have sewer that it's automatically not up for consideration. We would still need to go through and hear it. That could be a concern. It's definitely something that needs to be there, but.
But they can't develop it until there's sewer.
Can't develop it until there's sewer.
Yeah.
I just looked it up on eStats, and thankfully it has the 2.49, so if anybody just glanced at that, they got the right.
The only thing that apparently was the typo on the application.
It's great.
That's all I know on that one.
3674.
You have an updated staff report for this one in your folder.
I have a kind of a general question that does sort of pertain to this one. Some of these applications in our book will have an impact study. I'm assuming that's submitted by the applicant.
Yes.
But then some of them do not. So for instance, there's one that's 55 units that has an impact study. And then, I think it's the hopeful one. And then this one doesn't. I could not find in the UDC anything about an impact study, this particular staff, but I thought I would ask about. The one with the.
Just.
So this one is for Hopewell Group. 3663 has one. There are some errors in it, but I won't go into that.
What is the home set, what is the?
It's for 55 lots. It's for 55 lots. And then this one, my understanding is for 55 lots as well. Am I incorrect in that?
No, 74 has 55 lots also.
So that's why I was just wondering.
Which one didn't have it?
This one, 74.
74.
Right, Jane?
Right, the one, yeah, we're doing right now. Or I didn't see it, you know.
No, I didn't see it either. It has the constitutional on the way.
Both Res 3. No change there.
It could be, being written eval, impact statement, improvements and amenities, sometimes they're included in that.
Okay, so why does it look different then?
Sometimes the attorney will include that and improvements and amenities statement within the written evaluation.
And with the constitutional rights statement?
Sometimes that is.
So we require a written evaluation if it's 10 or more acres. The improvements and amenities is required for Res 3, 4, and 6. Depending on the applicant, these things are submitted in different formats. Meaning we do, when something comes in for zoning review, if they meet these thresholds, we have to make sure that they've got it, you know, improvements and amenities statement. We have to check for the written evaluation.
But it's not, I mean, I understand that they're coming in, they do it in two different ways, but it doesn't give the same information. I mean, for instance.
It just has to constitute what is considered an evaluation, though, right? I mean, does it, is it so specific?
we don't have essentially that's correct, but why don't we look back specifically at these two, and that will be something that.
Yeah, there's not a lot the ordinance requires there. Had that come up with Plan Commission years ago about the value of those ad. Sometimes they're not, some of these statements and not much more than the applicant right now. This is going to be wonderful, everything's going to be fine.
That's exactly right.
You're going to love this, just wait.
You're going to love this, I promise.
Twice as much as we're done.
Okay, so specifically, what I found to be beneficial in the impact statement, the public service impact statement from 3663, and like I said, there are some errors in it, but it gives you the market absorption over a 3-year period, beginning in 2014 with approximately 18 homes. I thought that was helpful.
Mm-hmm.
It gives you the average sales price of what they expect to be the homes to be. It gives you that the average household size in Forsyth County is 3.07 people per household. You know, it has a lot of the questions that we seem to ask frequently and that citizens ask of us. It seems to have answered that, and we don't see these a lot, so this was something that I just, you know, I took some time with this time. It does give some funding type calculations and all of that kind of stuff. Again, there's some errors, but at least it gives you your guideline for it. So it's just my 2 cents and wondering why one would have it and the other not.
Because it's
not
required.
Actually required.
So it's something. If you want to keep an eye on it, discuss it at a future work session and see if we want to make a recommendation to the board that we should require these 5 or 10 things in this. We should require it from maybe more groups than
sure.
We're getting it from now.
Okay.
I mean, one other way that you could do that is, and Tommy also gave us or asked us what we'd like to see in those evaluation kind of things, like the information we see in it.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, you could even put, I mean, we've already got a lot of form kind of information, but if you put it in a form format, it makes it kind of a voluntary entry. Like, they may not know what their market entry price is or what the absorption is going to be. They may not have done that analysis, but it's there. If they have it, then, you know, they would most likely put it in there.
The one of the weaknesses of it is that we'd have very limited ability to hold them to any of that.
No, and I'm not necessarily suggesting that it holds them to that. It just gives us a starting point for a discussion, and it does, you know, we ask that question. It doesn't
right.
necessarily mean we're holding them to it. It just, you know, gives us an idea of what their plan is for the development. Like you had asked, how long is it going to take to develop that property?
And
in this statement, it tells you.
And whether or not it's required in a specific place in the form, an applicant who gives us that information helps themselves.
Sure.
If you see something in there that you think's critical to you being comfortable with the application, you might want to work it into a zoning condition.
Absolutely.
Yeah, that is one thing, is if you ask for too much information and put it in there and it's not anything that compels them to do that, I mean, like,
yeah, there's not. It's not a fact.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Not based on a land use, a fact of what we specifically need in order to make a decision.
Yeah, working in Florida, we used to do these development or regional impact books for projects. I mean, you know, the DRI process down there was real extensive. And I mean, it would be over 1,000 pages of what of this painting of capacity issues and all of that. But at the end of the day, I don't know what project is going to say, yeah, it's not going to work.
Right, sure.
The economic picture is always going to be painted rosy in those kind of situations, it seems like. So I don't know, you know, it's, and I mean, you can look at current market trends and say, well, it does seem rosy right now. You don't know what it's really going to do, so.
Could we say based on the information they give us, you can do, you know, this percentage of it next year and this percentage of it the year after that and stuff to try to coordinate with whatever information we think we can get from the school? I don't know.
I'm going to, based on the discussion we already had in this meeting, I'm going to ask Ken to incorporate concurrency to schools as a greatest presentation for next month. And that's something, I thought Jane's summary of his comments from last year were pretty spot on, better than I remembered. And I'll ask him to give a refresher on that the second time it came up tonight.
So we're on 3674. Sorry,
I took
it off of this topic
a
little bit.
I was looking at the public participation report.
So we are on 3674.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
We haven't discussed it yet.
I want you guys to see this. It's not, it's easier to see here. This is a little bit unique. Because what they want to do with this development is basically attach to an existing res 3. So the hatch lines right here is not subject to the zoning, but would be part of the development as they're planning it.
Which
right
is
now.
Why on the site plan here, it shows
83
units, and there's 55 on the application because I freaked out.
Yeah. Yeah, so this is res 3. 9,000 square foot lot. I'm 95% certain about that. And if I could probably see that one. The piles that are here, they're going to be keeping them. This is on 141, which kind of goes here and then kind of comes down this way. There's some existing houses right here. This is actually R2R right now. There's a little spot that you can see that on your field. Oak Knoll is what it's called.
Those are 20,000 square foot lots.
Yes. I learned, I wasn't aware of this, actually two of those houses are going away with 141 being widened. And they look like this house here is a big house with a nice pool in the back. I just never noticed it driving by all the time because it's a little bit off the road. So I wanted you guys to see this because not, like you said, you saw that and you wondered about it. That was pointed out to me there. Given in our conversations, my conversations with the attorney, given that it's right across from Polo, which I know you guys just dealt with in Polo, so you're familiar with the density there. This is an interesting one because it's directly adjacent to this Red 3, which is 9,000 square foot lots. But just in the south, you've got Coventry, which is R2R. You've got R2R adjacent. You've got CR1 across the street, which is Polo, which is larger, but then CR1 right here, which is Silverleaf, is small,
I was going to say, so
losses.
Interesting, CR1, Silverleaf is 9,000.
Correct.
R2R, whatever this one is, 9,000.
Coventry.
Yep.
Coventry, 9,000. Across the street, Parkside at Polo Fields, 9,000. But then CR1 in Polo, 18. And then R2R, Polo, 25.
Right.
So it really never explains to you what the lot size is just based on the zoning category, ever.
Correct.
We need to figure out. Change our ordinances a lot more than typical communities. We keep pretty busy doing ordinance changes and zonings and don't do a lot of, all the 300 or so pages in our comprehensive plan. And me and the smart Vanessa, where she just kind of gave me some grief about how we don't do a whole lot with it. And we keep busy on other stuff here, good or bad. So yeah, they changed a lot.
It's
Vanessa did a report on CR1.
And
you wouldn't really find out it's changed like 8 times in its existence.
9 times.
Changed 9 different times.
Yes, those were all my questions that I had asked you with the dates.
It dovetailed into the research we were already doing, so it wasn't a problem. But it went on for 20 years without having to. because everything was regulated in the process.
One thing that they indicated that they are going to work on is drawing something with an 11,000 minimum. I haven't heard back on that yet. I'll check in on it this week and see if there's been progress made, but that was something they were going to take a look at. That was kind of the extent of our... We had a similar conversation that you look at this and you can look at something and say that, yeah, that lot size works. You can look at something else and say it doesn't and kind of average it all together. The average, I think if they get to the 11 that they talked about, I think that will help a lot and be in a good place looking at the picture in its entirety.
I was a little bit concerned about the lots being close to the road once it gets widened.
Mm-hmm.
We've seen a lot of builders coming back in at the last phase of their building and put that last house right there on the front of the neighborhood. And it's something else that I would like us to look at in terms of even a code change to put a distance from right of way or something to that respect. Not only based on aesthetics and how it looks in our county, but safety. I mean, if a car comes flying around, you know, this is going to be a busy, fast road. And if a car comes flying around and goes off and hits the house, that could be a very hazardous. So, and you could see that happening in several of these neighborhoods that are just being completed, where they're adding that extra home
mm-hmm.
right at the edge. You know, nothing we can do about that now, but we can look towards the future.
Yeah, my biggest concern being next to roads like that is really more of noise and light pollution. I mean, if the speed limit 35 to 55, the volume more than doubles. I mean, it's several times louder at 55 mile an hour road. So, you know, either...
Well, I'm guessing it would be a 55.
Significant grade separation. I'm not a huge fan of berms, but something that helps
to block it.
Block the noise level whenever you have those situations.
What are the options for that besides berms that you have seen?
I mean, you got the ugly DOT panels.
Yeah.
Grade separation's not too bad. If it's up a good bit higher, then it's not nearly as loud once you're up higher. But, you know, it's the same thing with lights. I mean, you know, headlights and things like that. If you're up higher, then...
Could be a brick wall rather than a DOT panel. That would be expensive.
Yeah, I mean, you have walls. In fact, when you go to the Gwinnett side of 141, the Fulton side of down farther south, you do see a lot of those have large brick and stone
St.
walls,
Marlo
and that's probably
that.
A lot of the reason why.
St. Ives.
Yeah.
Because
mm-hmm.
otherwise, it would be hard to sell homes with that kind of noise.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Anything else on this one?
Not for me.
Have you heard from residents?
No, in fact, I was not able to send this public participation report and have not heard from, I've heard from two people. And that's where my lot size conversation came from, was from their feedback.
So we now do have the public participation report.
Right. Looking at it, I couldn't see any.
Wasn't anything in here.
Yeah, I didn't see any questions that were asked.
Really?
So,
yeah.
There was no
there's a list of people, but I don't see any questions or answers
what they
or
to submit.
What was discussed.
I thought I was just missing it. So
no, you're not.
We talked about this a couple times ago, too, in that they're not submitting what they need to submit. Because honestly,
it's just their composite summary. So we're on 3674, correct?
Yeah.
Yes.
So they talk on page 2, composite summary of concerns, buffers and landscaping, stormwater, detention, minimum house sizes.
Again, we don't require specific Is that correct?
Yeah, and you're going to see a variability. I know we've discussed this before in the past as to we do in the code outline, these are the, basically the headings that you've got to hit, but the level of detail that needs to be provided is not stringent.
So this one will be ready to proceed. They're not going to be asking for a postponement.
That's not clear to me, because I haven't heard anything back since we had our conversation about a new drawing, which I've not seen a new drawing with 11,000 square foot minimum. So I don't know if that's. I'll check in on that and email you individually and let you know what I find on that one.
We can just wait until Tuesday.
Okay.
3675 United Family Homes.
This one is, they're going to request a postponement. We can certainly discuss it though, because I think that this has been subject of a number of
postponement based on
emails.
Wait,
postponement based on the homeowners and the applicant are trying to resolve their differences. A couple homeowners have hired an attorney. And this is one of the more contentious zonings that I've seen. This backs up to the Westbrook subdivision, which is off of Kelly Mill. There's a number of, and I think that you guys probably receive these emails as well, but there's a number of concerns on this. It got to the point that I talked to somebody last night that the homeowners had gotten together and tried to go make an offer to buy this land themselves. And found out that it's already been closed on, so they could not buy it. But they were troubled enough that they, my understanding is, rounded up a couple people that were willing just to go try to buy it.
That's really surprising to me because Westbrook is a very dense subdivision.
It's like Victory without the commercial.
Yeah. It's really pretty.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it is very dense.
Yep. So. What the, if you look at the site plan, one of their major concerns, and they said, quite frankly, being transparent, shame on us, we didn't look into it, but that topo is so bad back there that we just thought it was unbuildable, and we never even thought that this would become a zoning. And, you know, they of their own accord said, we know that's our fault, but that's kind of why this is. I think has rallied them so much. There's a lot of, they have a lot of concerns about water and buffering against the back of their neighborhood. Now part of what was done, I'm not sure if it's on this drawing or not, the applicant had made all of the lot sizes, or was proposing that all of the lot sizes go back up to Westbrook be a minimum of 12,000. And the ones across the street from that minimum of 10, it's the rest 3.
Did they line them up to where they were with the Westbrook lot? There was an issue about that at one time.
Yeah, I mean, if you look here, you kind of see that. I don't have a copy of the new drawing. I know that was a concern, and that's something that I talked to one of the guys from Westbrook last night at a different event, and they are convinced that they're going to have serious water problems with this. And that's a concern. The other concern is that, not the only ones that have expressed this in the past, but that what they have behind them is going, with the lot sizes and without the buffering, is going to, they're going to not be looking at the back of somebody else's house, potentially lined up, as you said, Pam. So.
This conforms to everything it's supposed to conform to. The staff was supportive of this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I think that their hope is, when I say their hope, I mean the applicant's hope, is that we have agreed to set a meeting between a group from Westbrook and the applicant. to sit down and have a conversation. They have, none of the residents have ever met the applicant, and they would like to do that. Like, there was the attorney and the engineer, there was at the public participation meeting. They've expressed some concerns about the applicant in particular that I told them is irrelevant as far as our decision goes, but they've expressed it nonetheless. So I think that for their peace of mind, they'd like to have a meeting, and at least the attorney has indicated that they're more than open to having a meeting with the attorney. But who else would attend that meeting? I don't know yet. We're talking about doing that in May.
Talking about doing that in May?
Having the meeting in May. They are going to request a postponement.
Okay. So we're waiting on written verification.
That is correct. I have received.
But then we have to vote if they do, in fact, ask for a postponement. Well, moving on to 3677, which seems to be not contentious, I don't believe.
Joe Biden's review of this one.
Mm-hmm. This is zone CBD, and they are requesting to be beyond zone to A1.
Right now, it's a house.
It's a house. What species plan on keeping it a house?
It came into our office wanting to permit a pool. A pool for a home is not allowed in CBD, so we told them they couldn't give them a permit for a pool. And my guess is that's what sparked this.
Yeah.
I was told that was triggering this as well. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, because there is some mention in something about a outbuilding or something, and I didn't understand what that was. Now I do understand what it is.
I have some questions on the staff report of this one, just for future reference. So on our comprehensive plan, when we have thoroughfare character area, heavy industrial character area, that means it can basically be anything up to that intensive of a use? Is that?
It could be. Now, a heavy industrial area is only for those sites that are developed as a mine or plant. So that is not a future land use, but a present land use. Thoroughfare is, you know, specifically with thoroughfare, let me just pull this up.
Well, it says it's primarily designated within. So
right,
usually
exactly.
That means part of the comprehensive plan.
For thoroughfare, it's really looking at any request to have it back to ag as keeping was
okay.
Let me ask you, I mean, because I think I've seen a couple of times where it was accepted that the land use map isn't the sole driver of whether it's going to be supportive or unsupportive. Like in this case where there's ag all around it, even if it didn't have ag in the future
with
land
the
use
down zoning, we're not going to be unsupportive more than likely, because the fact of the matter is that it'll probably be redeveloped, you know, if it goes back to ag, is likely to be redeveloped as a long-range planning area, you know, for what
sure.
Proposal. We're not saying, let's say you're in a development corridor for whatever reason you wanted to go back to ag. We're not going to be, I would say, non-supportive of that, because the idea would be...
No, yeah,
you know,
I'm not worried about that. I was trying to understand for future, you know, not necessarily this one, but for future, it's basically from A1 up to whatever it is.
Whatever
is this?
It is. Yeah.
Okay.
That is correct.
And then my other question is, on every single one, criteria number 4, the proposed residential zoning will result in a use that could cause excessive burden to the existing utilities, streets, and schools.
Now, this is not going to change or cause any kind of excessive burden. I don't see how we can take that statement seriously on any of the other ones.
That's why we're going to be talking about the staff report in June. We can't get it on May simply because we've got Ken coming. We've got a short-term work program. But, you know, our intention for the June work session on that topic is to look at the staff report as, you know, how we can improve it.
Okay.
And we have certainly heard your issues with the criteria, especially this one, on how to clear. So we are specifically going to be looking at that in addition
and
to
like
some
I get it with all the other ones, because then I could see, okay, well, you could say it could cause a burden event, you know, I mean, at certain points. But this one, it's like, I don't even know how you could, it's already there. It's not changing anything. It's not,
what's the land use of that category, though, not the current use that you would be evaluating? So, I mean, we know in this case that she's talking about using it as a pool, but somebody else could buy it and use it for other agricultural.
No, well, what, yeah, well, but it, but I'm, what I'm saying is it's A1, I don't see how A1 could be, could cause more burden than the CBD. You see what I mean? Because it is CBD now.
From the current zoning.
Correct.
And moving it off that
we need to fix
statement.
That.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's a matter of fitting it on the work session, but also Vanessa and I just getting time to get into it.
Sure.
We met a couple days ago. We kicked around some ideas. We looked at tech reviews from Alpharetta, Johns Creek, Milton, a couple out of state.
Okay.
We'll get into it. It's on a long list of items.
I understand. And
I agree. I agree. This, if it never changes, it shouldn't be on there because it's not adding value. And on this one, not only does it not change, but it.
And I don't want us.
It's hard.
And I don't want us to go through here and say, well, I don't really need to read that because that's usually just useless. I don't want us to breach that.
And that's
point.
Where I think we started some of this discussion was saying, what in here is useful and what isn't,
yeah.
let's fine tune it to make sure you find value in using it.
Right.
And
that's a perfect time.
This particular example is one that came out of that.
Yeah, because I think there are some things that are in here that we don't use, and it's a kind of a waste of resources, paper. And
well, you know, part of the discussion in June will be things that we've seen that and suggestions on improvement, but also hearing from you of there could be other things that come out of that June discussion.
Cool. Thank you.
So will someone give me the time?
8:51.
I make a motion to adjourn the meeting. May I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Commissioner Iglesias. All those is there any discussion about this? All those in favor of the motion to adjourn the meeting, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? That motion passes. 5-0, we're adjourned at what time was it again? 8:51 p.m.
Has anybody ever been opposed to the motion?
No, but you know, I have to ask.
Yeah, because
you
somebody might want
to
bring up
throw
something
us
else.
For a loop.
That's right. It might be raining hard outside or something.
That's right.
33 degrees.
What did you say?
It's not 33 degrees yet.
I don't want to hear
so
that.
So do I need to wheel my lemon trees in tonight or not?
Yeah, I know.
You do. It's going to get to 30.
Yeah,
they got four big lemons on them.
Oh, you better bring them.
Oh, you better bring them in.
I have a, what's it called? Hibiscus tree.
Yeah. He ought to come in tonight.
He wasn't looking so good anyways.
Let me see what it says if they've come out with a forecast on timing.
I saw a low of 30 at 6 o'clock. It's going to cool off at 1.
At 1 a.m. is 36. Oh, 32. 30 at 7 a.m. Yeah, well, then I better bring them in.
Miami.
Put a blankie on them. You know, they have those, like.
I know. I don't have the giant trash bags, but in the wind, they act like a sail.
That's true. It is. Super windy.
Good night.
Good night, Robert.
Good night, Vanessa.
See
good
you.
To see you.
See you next Tuesday.
Yep.
See you soon.
Okay.